I would like to share some thoughts with you about indoor climate in schools. And as a consultant, I've been investigating schools for about 20 years together with my colleague Vroukje van Dijken. And what we're presenting here is referring to some research we did for the Dutch government, also some work we did with Klima conferences and with Riva, and just a short insight in what's happening in terms of indoor climate in schools. This is a figure we've used a lot in the Netherlands about 10 years ago when we tried to get indoor climate in schools on the agenda. And it's a study that my colleague Vroukje van Dijken did 10 years ago. And this was a selection of 11 schools in the Netherlands. And what you basically see here is that in an ideal scenario, you want an air quality that relates to CO2 concentration of about 1200 ppm maximum, basically. And you see that most of the schools we investigated, if you look at the white areas here, that's where the average was. And these are, of course, the extremes, the P90 and the P10. What you see is that already the average values are around 2,000 and not below 1,200, so at least a factor too high. And I'm showing this picture because I've seen figures from other countries, and generally speaking, this is what you often find in most countries, that if you look at CO2 concentrations in schools, it's very high in schools. I once presented this for a group of Dutch mayors to try to convince them to do something about this. And then I don't have that picture with me, but I also showed them a graph about the CO2 concentrations in prisons, Dutch prisons, and they are like 800 or something. So the basic conclusion was that it's more than two times worse in schools than in prisons. And from a political point of view, that's a little bit difficult to explain, I think. Okay. Of course, if you talk about air quality in schools, it's about more than just CO2. You can talk about volatile organic compounds or fine particles, but CO2 is one of the big issues, so that's why I'm only showing something about CO2. Okay, so what does it mean, the fact that indoor climate, if you have a school with a suboptimal indoor climate, what does it mean? If you don't have good air quality, you get problems, of course, with discomfort. You might remember from your own school, like if you walk into a classroom with a lot of people in there, you get smelly air, olfactory discomfort, a surplus of body odors. But that's not the most important, I think. What you also get is some short-term health effects. Irritation of the eyes, of the nose, maybe dry air feeling, generally SBS symptoms, headaches, the kind of systems that you can get and that will go away if you leave the building. And from studies we also know that if you have not very good indoor air quality, then you get a spread of infectious disease through the air. And basically, if you put a lot of children in a room together and you don't ventilate that room well, then they'll make each other ill, basically. And so that's another reason to make sure that you have good ventilation in classrooms. And in this context, it may be interesting, when you had the SARS epidemics in the world, especially in Asia, then one of the first measures they did is closing the schools for a week, because these were points where people were making each other ill, like public transport was another example. Okay, so what does it mean? What does it lead to? Of course, if you make each other ill, you get increased sick leave. I'll show a figure about that later. You get decreased performance of the teachers, but also of the children, decreased learning performance. I have another picture about that later. And of course, like Bjarne said before, there's costs involved with this, costs that are much higher than the cost for energy, for example, or maintenance of the building. This is from a study in the US, where they looked at how air quality in schools and high CO2 concentrations have an impact on sickness leave. And they basically found that if you have not very good ventilated classrooms that generally have CO2 concentrations above 1000 ppm most of the time, you get an increase of 10 to 20% of the student absence. And as you see, this was quite a large study. There are other studies that have looked at this, and these are generally, this is generally what you find. So basically, if you want a school where people are there, children attend the lessons, it's a good idea to invest in good air quality and to make sure you have enough fresh air coming in. Well, then if you look at learning performance, what I'm showing here is a combination of different studies. One of the studies is done by Powell, who just gave the presentation. And the blue one is a study that TNO, the Dutch Research Institute, did here in the Netherlands. And this is an American study, and this one is, I think it's Swedish and Danish combined. But anyhow, so what we looked at, most of these studies, they looked at learning performance in an ideal situation and learning performance in a sub-ideal situation. So for example, this is a study where they had one situation with 2 liters per second per student, and then again they did this, the learning performance test with 6 liters per second per person, and then they compared the relative performance. We combined all these data to make some kind of a dosis effect relation that shows you how ventilation rate impacts performance. And then we, at a random point, in this case 4 liters per second per person, we said it was going to be 100 and the rest then relative towards that. So here it's 10% better than here, and here it's 10% worse than there. And what you see here is that this is the new Dutch guideline for, this is probably the highest in Europe, 8 liters per second per person. This is in the new building code. And it still tells you that there's still options for improvement of the learning performance if you go higher up. But just to give you a little bit of feeling of what good ventilation could do with learning performance and with maybe the grades of your children, this is the study we did in the Netherlands about a math test outcome, so just doing simple calculations and seeing how many mistakes they make. And here you see that at 4 liters per second, if you put that at 100, then it was about 20% better. So they made 20% less mistakes when you would increase the ventilation rate to a little bit over 12 liters per second. So that's 3 times higher. And that's a lot, 20%. That's the difference between a 5.5 on a 10-point scale and a 7. And this is something that might interest quite a few children and students and parents. An extra reason to make sure that if you invest in schools, you also invest in good ventilation. This is when, as a consultant, we are involved in projects, it's always important to make sure that the people making the decisions have a good broad understanding of what should be done to make sure that the indoor air quality is good in a building in general. So, for example, in an office building. And basically what this picture tells you is that there's a few things you have to make sure that are okay. One is that you have enough fresh air coming in, and of course some air going out. That air can come in here or maybe through like a ventilation, Dauerluftung or something, but from anywhere you should have enough fresh air supply. Another thing, Paul was just referring to that, it's very important that air, when it's going through these ducts and the air handling unit, it doesn't get dirty, so it's clean, it doesn't meet any molds in there and stuff, so that the air that's coming in is not polluting on the way. Another thing that, there's quite a few studies that show that it's important that people have control over their indoor climate, so give them some kind of button or knob on the wall that where they can influence the fresh air supply with, or even better, an operable window. It depends a little bit of the location. And then you have to make sure that the materials you put in, and whether it's like a printer, or whether it's carpets, or whether it's furnishing, or maybe wooden tables, that you make sure that these are all low emission and have some kind of low emission label. Of course, if you this only works if you have a good location with adequate outdoor air quality, So not directly, especially if a school, not like 100 or 50 meters next to a very busy highway, that's not going to work, especially because the children will play outside part of the time. And you have to make sure that rooms are used as designed. So if you have a classroom that's designed for 20 people and you put 30 people in, that's not going to work either. So I think these are like the basic six things that if you do them right, then you have avoided 90% of the standard IQ problems, and people will not have sick building symptoms and have good learning performance. Okay, very shortly, it's not just about air quality, it's also about thermal comfort. Bjarne said some things about this already. In schools, for example, overheating is often a problem. So that's one thing. One way to avoid that is to make sure that you don't have too much glass, for example, or if you do have glass, that you have good outside sunscreens. And then local thermal discomfort, for example, draft. That's really a challenge in schools because you need a lot of fresh air because you have a lot of people per square meter, and to put the fresh air in, it's quite a challenge. You need good air inlets, for example. And then again, personal control is important. For example, with temperature, that you have, for example, adjustable wall thermostats, so teachers can adjust the temperature if necessary. Okay, this is more or less my last slide. Challenges in schools. Like I said, it's you compared to an office building or a dwelling, a house, for example, you have a lot of people per square meter. So if you are designing a school, or analyzing a school, it's very important to look at that. And again, you need relatively a lot of fresh air supply per square meter. It's very difficult to get that fresh air in without draft problems. It's possible, but it's a bit more complicated, and you need a little bit more higher quality air inlets than, for example, in an office. This is very important too. In a school, often in schools, there's very little budget for maintenance. So it's good to design for low maintenance to make it kind of foolproof. And these are some examples of schools we've studied. This is very a new school. To be honest, it's 3 weeks old, this one. So that's just the dust from the installation. So that's not a good start. This one is an interesting one. This is like from the children of about 5-6 years old, and this was an underfloor duct, and of course people they will lose stuff and it will fall in and you get all kinds of dirt in here, and this doesn't look like the air, the children are getting really fresh and healthy air in their lungs. Another thing is it's very important to make things simple, and because the average teacher isn't a very technical person, so make sure that the ergonomics are as simple as possible. Okay, before I conclude, if you want to know more about the subject, Klima, especially, I think Olli Seppänen has been one of the big initiators for this. Riva has done a lot for schools, for example, a couple of workshops, and this culminated about 2 years ago in this guideline, Indoor Environment and Energy Efficiency in Schools. You can order this guidebook. I'm actually one of the co-authors of this. You can order this guidebook through this website, and it costs, I think, about 30 euros. So thank you very much for your attention, and let me know if you have any questions.